Hello, this is Akram Jafar, and in this video I'm going to deal with some picture tests and practical anatomy of the lower limb. This video deals with the posterior compartment of the leg and the sole of the foot. You may use the video as a revision or as a self-assessment tool. For the purpose of self-assessment, pause the video and spend some time to read the question and come up with the answer. Then replay the video to confirm your answer by listening to the comments and explanations. Identify the structures 1 and 2. 1 is the tendon of peroneus longus muscle. You can see that the tendon of peroneus longus comes from the lateral side of the foot, grooves the cuboid bone. This is the groove of the cuboid. And here it is the bridged by the long plantar ligament and then crosses the plantar side of the foot to be attached to the base of the fifth metatarsal and the medial cuneiform bone, just opposite to the attachment of tibialis anterior muscle. 2 is the long plantar ligament. It passes from the plantar surface of the calcaneus to the cuboid bone and bridges the groove on the cuboid and converts it into a tunnel for the passage of the tendon of peroneus longus muscle. The short plantar ligament is deep to the long plantar ligament. Which of the labeled muscles is supplied by the deep peroneal nerve? Let's identify the muscles first. This is the medial side of the ankle and foot. Muscle 1 is a long muscle coming from the back of the leg, and you can see the tendon of the muscle is attached to the distal phalanx of the big toe. This is the flexor hallucis longus and is supplied by the tibial nerve. So it's not supplied by the deep peroneal. Muscle 2, it's attached to the medial cuneiform and the base of the first metatarsal bone. This is tibialis anterior muscle, and as any other member of the anterior group of leg muscles, is supplied by the deep peroneal nerve. Muscle 3 is the abductor hallucis muscle. It is a muscle of the sole of the foot, the first layer of the sole of the foot, and is supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Muscle 4, this is the tendon of tibialis posterior, grooving behind the medial malleolus and is attached to the navicular bone here. Tibialis posterior is supplied by the tibial nerve. 5 is the Achilles tendon or the calcaneal tendon attached to the calcaneus. 2 muscles attached to the tendon, the soleus and gastrocnemius, and these are supplied by the tibial nerve. So only tibialis anterior here, number 2, is supplied by the deep peroneal nerve. Identify the muscles and the tendons that produce the surface landmark 1 to 4. 1 is the superficial muscle in the calf region. This is the gastrocnemius muscle, which forms the belly gaster of the cnemi, back of the leg, hence the name gastrocnemius. 2 is the muscle deeper to it but bulkier than it, and this is the soleus muscle. And these two muscles, the two heads of gastrocnemius and the soleus, they form a muscle which has a common tendon, which is called the calcaneal tendon because it's attached to the calcaneus. And the muscle, the common muscle, is from the triceps suri, two heads of gastrocnemius and soleus. 3 is the tendon of a muscle that is on the lateral side of the leg, and this is the tendon of peroneus longus muscle. Peroneus longus is superficial to peroneus brevis, so it is the muscle whose tendon can be seen underneath the skin. Which muscles invert, plantar flex, dorsiflex, inserts to a tarsal bone? Let's identify these muscles. This is a dissection of the deep aspect of the medial side of the leg, ankle joint, and the sole of the foot. You can see here that the muscle A comes from the anterior side. It is the tibialis anterior muscle and is attached to the tarsal bone, medial cuneiform bone. Also, it's attached to a metatarsal, but it's attached to a tarsal bone, and it dorsiflexes as well as it inverts because it's attached to the medial side of the foot in front of the talonavicular joint, and so it can invert, but it doesn't plantar flex, it dorsiflexes. Muscle B is tibialis posterior, grooves behind the medial malleolus of the tibia, and is attached to the navicular bone. This muscle, it inverts because it's attached to the tarsal bones, navicular, on the medial side of the foot, so it elevates the medial side of the foot, it inverts, and it plantar flexes at the same time. It doesn't dorsiflex. C is the flexor digitorum longus. You can see here that it splits into 4 tendons to supply the digits. It's not inserted into the tarsal bones. It is inserted to the phalanges. It doesn't dorsiflex. It plantar flexes. And it doesn't invert. D is the bulky muscle, the muscle that has more flesh than the other muscles of the deep compartment of the posterior aspect of the leg. This is the flexor hallucis longus, and you can see the tendon extends to the big toe. It's invert, it plantar flexes, and is not attached to a tarsal bone. It doesn't dorsiflex. E is the triceps suri, the Achilles tendon, which is attached to the tarsal bone, which is the calcaneus. That's why it's called tendocalcaneus, and it plantar flexes. It doesn't dorsiflex, and it doesn't invert. Which couple of the following joints is used for inversion and eversion movements? The first joint is the metatarsophalangeal joint of the big toe, and it's not used for inversion and eversion. Then the other joint is the tarsometatarsal joint of the big toe between the medial cuneiform and the first metatarsal, and it doesn't invert and evert. This joint here between the trochlea of the talus and the tibia and fibula, this is the ankle joint. There's no inversion and eversion allowed at the ankle joint, only dorsiflexion and plantar flexion. Remember that the joints of inversion and eversion should be distal to the talus. In dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, the talus is considered as part of the foot, and so it moves the foot. But in inversion and eversion, the talus is considered as part of the leg, and the joints distal to the talus are going to move, and these are these joints, C and E. So C is the talocalcaneonavicular joint, and E is the calcaneocuboid joint. Both of them, functionally speaking, they constitute what we call the transverse tarsal joint. In addition to the joint which is present here, which is the subtalar joint, these are the joints of inversion and eversion. So the couple of the joints here involved in inversion and eversion are C and E, calcaneocuboid and the talocalcaneonavicular joint. The continuation of this joint is not shown here in the X-ray. Which muscle can still plantar flex the ankle when the Achilles tendon is torn? Here, as you can see, that even after the tearing of the Achilles tendon, Cobb Bryant was still able to plantar flex the knee. Although the main plantar flexor of the ankle is the triceps suri muscle, that is now ineffective because of the tear of the Achilles tendon, but there are other plantar flexors, including tibialis posterior, flexor digitorum longus, and flexor hallucis longus. Identify the fossa, what is attached to it. This is the distal end of the fibula. You can see that there is a smooth surface here and here. The smooth surface is for articulation with the talus, with the trochlea of the talus. Trochlea of the talus articulates with the tibia and the fibula. The fossa is called the malleolar fossa, referring to the lateral malleolus. And the smooth surface is called the malleolar facet. It articulates with the lateral side of the trochlea of the talus. The fossa provides attachment of a strong ligament called the posterior tibiofibular ligament. This ligament extends between the malleolar fossa of the fibula and the posterior edge of the tibia, and it prevents the leg to slide forward on the talus under the influence of gravity when the foot is plantar flexed at the takeoff stage in walking. Posterior tibiofibular ligaments. Sometimes it's difficult to differentiate between right and left fibula, so we look at the fossa and the facet. If the fossa is on the left side of the facet, then it is the left fibula. If the fossa is on the right side of the facet, then it is the right fibula. So the left fibula is this one, A. Identify the vessel, which compartment in the leg it mainly supplies. In this dissection of the posterior aspect of the leg, you can see here that the multipinnate soleus muscle has been cut and reflected from below. And here, this is the arch in its origin. The soleus arises from both tibia and fibula. And in between them, there is an arch in the origin. Deep to the arch passes the posterior tibial artery. I can continue the posterior tibial artery here, accompanied by the tibial nerve. One of the branches of the posterior tibial artery, which is given from the lateral side, is called the fibular artery or the peroneal artery. And as you can see it here, it passes on the lateral side and it sends perforating branches that that supply the lateral compartment of the leg. The lateral compartment, which contains peroneus longus and peroneus brevis, doesn't have an artery passing into it, so it depends on the peroneal artery, which sends perforating branches. The peroneal artery remains in the posterior compartment, but mainly supplies the lateral compartment of the leg by perforating branches. In this angiogram, identify the labeled vessels A and B. A is the arcuate artery, which is the continuation of the dorsalis pedis artery, crossing the dorsum of the foot from medial to lateral and providing metatarsal branches. B passes behind the medial malleolus. It is the posterior tibial artery, and here are its terminal branches, the medial and lateral plantar arteries. Identify the muscle indicated by the arrow. What is its nerve supply? This muscle is the flexor digitorum brevis. It is the member of the first layer of muscles of the sole, and it divides into four tendons that fuse with the tendon of flexor digitorum longus. Flexor digitorum brevis, as you can see, is attached to the calcaneus, and these are the four tendons to the lateral four toes. It is comparable in its insertion to the insertion of flexor digitorum superficialis in the upper limb. Flexor digitorum superficialis in the upper limb is supplied by the median nerve, which is the preaxial nerve, the nerve close to the thumb. The preaxial nerve here in the sole of the foot is the medial plantar nerve, the nerve that is close to the big toe. So the muscle is supplied by the medial plantar nerve. Identify the muscles A and B. What is the function of each? A and B belong to the second layer of the muscles of the sole of the foot. A is the quadratus plantae. It is quadrangular in shape and is attached to the tendon of flexor digitorum longus. This is the tendon in flexor digitorum longus. You can see how it splits into four tendons. So quadratus plantae, and the action of this muscle is that it acts as an accessory digital flexor. So it flexes the digits without flexing the ankle joint if the flexor digitorum longus is going to be used. That's why this muscle is sometimes called flexor digitorum accessorius. In addition, it straightens the oblique pull of the tendon of flexor digitorum longus muscle. B is the flexor digitorum longus, and as the name indicates, the muscle arises from the leg, posterior compartment of the leg, and so it plantar flexes the ankle joint, but as the name of the muscle indicates, it splits into four tendons, and they fuse with the tendon of flexor digitorum brevis. So this muscle here, flexor digitorum longus, it acts like the flexor digitorum profundus of the upper limb, while the flexor digitorum brevis acts like the flexor digitorum superficialis of the upper limb. It flexes the flexor digitorum longus B, it flexes the lateral four toes, and it flexes the distal interpharyngeal joints. Identify the vessel and the accompanying nerve. This is a superficial dissection of the posterior aspect of the leg, and the vessel here is the small saphenous vein. You can follow it down to behind the lateral malleolus, and then here it disappears because it perforates the popliteal fascia, where it's going to be to drain into the deep vein, which is the popliteal vein. The nerve that accompanies it is the sural nerve, and this is a branch of the tibial nerve as well as the common peroneal nerve. It supplies the skin on the distal part of the posterior aspect of the leg and the lateral side of the foot. Identify the structures A and B. These are the four tendons of the flexor digitorum longus. You can see quadratus plantae attached to the tendon of flexor digitorum longus. And remember that the flexor digitorum longus is comparable to the flexor digitorum profundus in the upper limb. So it is the tendons of these muscles that give rise to the lumbricals. So A is the lumbrical muscle, is a lumbrical muscle. Here are the other lumbrical muscles. This is the first lumbrical muscle. While here, this muscle, which again has four tendons, is the flexor digitorum brevis, which is comparable to the flexor digitorum superficialis in the upper limb. Has no lumbricals attached to its tendons. Match the letter tendon A to D with the numbered muscle 1 to 5. So these are the tendons here. A is the tendon that closely related to the medial malleolus. It is the tibialis posterior. Then digitorum Remember the mnemonic, Tom did a nice home. Did is the digitorum, so this is the flexor digitorum longus. And then home, flexor hallucis longus. You can easily identify the tendon of flexor hallucis longus because the muscle is beef to the heel. It is fleshy. And then D is the Achilles tendon. Now let's compare that to the muscles here. Muscle one is located above the soleal line of the tibia. This is the popliteus muscle, and it does not reach, although it is located in the posterior compartment of the leg, but it doesn't reach the ankle joint. Its tendon passes upwards and acts on the knee joint. It is the unlocker of the locked knee. Two is soleus muscle. This is only part of the soleus. The other part of the soleus has been removed. Soleus, together with gastrocnemius, you can see the stumps of both muscle, they are attached to the tendocalcaneus D. So D matches with 2. 5 is the flexor hallucis longus, and it matches with C. And 4 is the tibialis posterior. Note that the tibialis posterior arises from both the tibia and fibula and the interosseous membrane, and it matches with A. And then we have 3 is the flexor digitorum longus. Flexor digitorum longus arises from the tibia, but it supplies the lateral 4 digits. So it's going to cross the tendon of tibialis posterior and the tendon of flexor hallucis longus.